governments of that time. They're responsible for the killing of Uthman radiallahu anhum right in his house. They surrounded his house. Some of the scholars say for 20 days. Some of the scholars say for 40 days. And they besieged Uthman radiallahu anhu in his home. And then they entered his home and they killed him. His wife tried to protect him. He was close to 90 years old. Over 90 years old. And his wife, the wife of Uthman, she raised her hand. As the blow came down upon Uthman, as she raised her hand, they sliced off all of her fingers of her hand. And then they took another blow. And then they finished Uthman radiallahu anhu off. These Khawarij. Why? Because they said Uthman is not ruling correctly in the manner that we want. Then after they killed Uthman, then there came the reign of Ali. And then they killed Ali radiallahu anhu. They assassinated him. After Ali took an army against them. Then one of them assassinated him. Another one, he stabbed Hassan bin Ali ibn Abi Talib in his leg, in his thigh. And they continued in this manner. So when the time came and the latter time of the Sahaba, and from them was Abu Umama al-Bahili radiallahu anhu, that he saw that the Khawarij, this sect, this rebellious, that is present today even in our times, he found that their heads have been decapitated and they'd been placed upon stakes leading into the pathway to the Grand Mosque in Damascus. He saw them and he looked at them and then he said, indeed I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, hum kilabun nar, hum kilabun nar, hum kilabun nar. And he repeated it three times. Indeed, they are the dogs of the hellfire. They are the dogs of the hellfire. They are the dogs of the hellfire. Referring to whom? Referring to those individuals whose heads had been cut. And their heads had been placed upon stakes. And then he started weeping. Because he realized, look how shaitan leads astray the son of Adam. These individuals who took the shahada, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. Then after entering into the fold of Islam, shaitan led them astray. Like you see in our times, sometimes a new Muslim will enter into Islam from Christianity, from Judaism, from Hinduism, from Sikhism. And then within a year, he regards himself to be the vanguard of Islam. That he's ready to strap Semtex upon his body and blow himself up. Within a year of Islam, how shaitan leads them astray. This is deviation. A deviation that shaitan calls them to due to their ignorance, due to their lack of knowledge. So then they enter into these pathways of misguidance. So when he saw them and he shed tears at the state of the children of Adam after entering into Islam, then he said, indeed, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, that the Jews, they split up into 71 sects. The Christians, they split up into 72 sects. And this Ummah will split up into 73 sects. Kulluhum finnar. Every single one of them is in the hellfire. Except for one. Illa wahida wa hiya al-jama'ah. Except for one. And that is the jama'ah. And then he mentioned to his companion who was next to him. He said, look. The Jews, they split up into 71. The Christians, they split up into 72. And the Ummah of Muhammad is more sectarian than the Jews and the Christians. There are more sects amongst the Muslims than there are amongst the Jews and Christians. And the one that is saved amongst them is the Jama'ah. We are not in a position, my brothers and sisters, to ignore this hadith. Because this hadith was mentioned by the companions of Allah's Messenger. And it was utilized by the companions of Allah's Messenger. Who was the Jama'ah in that time? In the time of the Sahaba. When Abdullah ibn Mubarak, rahimahullah ta'ala, the great Imam who died in the year 181 after the Hijrah. Abdullah ibn Mubarak was asked, who is the Jama'ah? He said, the Jama'ah is Abu Bakr and Umar. So the people said, قَدْ مَاتَ أَبُو بَكْرُ وَعُمَرُ. The Abu Bakr and Umar are dead. Then he said, then the Jama'ah It's so and so and so and so. They said, well, so and so and so and so is also dead. Then he said, the Jama'ah is Abu Hamza al-Sukkari al-Khurasani, the great Imam and the teacher of Abdullah ibn Mubarak from Khurasan of that era. So they understood what the Jama'ah was. The Jama'ah is that which was represented by Abu Bakr and Umar and the companions radiallahu anhum. The Jama'ah is represented by those who came after them, who held on to the truth. This is the Jama'ah that Abu Umama al-Bahili radiallahu anhu was talking about when he mentioned that the Muslims will split up more than the Jews, more than the Christians. All of them will enter into the hellfire except for one, and it is the Jama'ah. The great companion, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he mentioned a hadith, or he mentioned an occurrence that took place whilst the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was alive. He mentioned, خَطَّ لَنَا رُسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ خَطًّا ثُمَّ قَالَ هَذَا سَبِيلُ اللَّهِ. That the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam drew for us a line. And then he said, this is the straight path of Allah. Then he drew lines to the right, then he drew lines to the left. And then he said, هَذِهِ سُبُلٌ مُتَّفَرِّقَ. These are paths which are divergent and separating paths. And then he said, عَلَى كُلِّ سَبِيلٍ عَلَى كُلِّ سَبِيلٍ. Upon the head of every single path, مِنْهَا شَيْطَانٍ يَدْعُو إِلَيْهِ. Upon the head of each of those dividing paths is a devil at the head of them calling you to it, calling to that path. What we understand from this hadith is that the Messenger of Allah drew one line in the sand and he mentioned that this is the path of Allah. Then when he drew the other paths, he called them divergent, deviated paths. At the head of each one of them is a devil calling to it. Imagine, my brothers and sisters, that if there was a line that is drawn straight down, because this is something that is important for us to note, a line drawn in the sand, then the Messenger of Allah draw lines away from that one path, to the right and to the left, as Abdullah ibn Mas'ud mentioned. Then he mentioned at the head of each one of those lines, there's a devil calling to it. Which head? Are we looking at the end of the line, or are we looking at the beginning of the line, closest to the straight path? Which of the two? Imagine, there's the lines going that way, there's the center line. The lines are going that way. Where's the shaitan standing? At the line that is at the end of those short lines that are closest to the line, the straight path, or further away? Closest. Why? Because they are calling to those paths. They call to those paths, my brothers and sisters, those shayateen, because they are standing close to the straight path. They are standing close to the truth. And then they call people and they say, look, we have something that resembles the truth. We have something that resembles the truth. Come to us. Then you embark upon that path. Then where does that path take you? Closer to the straight path or further away? Further away. Where's the proof for this? This proof for this is in the behavior or in that incident that took place in the time of the companions. In the time when Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu, the companion, he entered the masjid in Iraq. He entered the masjid and he saw the people counting. They were sitting in circles and they were counting stones. One of them would pick up a stone and he would say, Alhamdulillah. Then the people in the circle would repeat after him, Alhamdulillah. Then he would pick up and he would repeat that 100 times, and the people repeat after him 100 times. Then he would pick up another stone and say, Subhanallah. Then the people repeat after him, Subhanallah, 100 times. Then likewise, Allahu Akbar. Then La ilaha illallah. Dhikr. Is there anything wrong with dhikr? Nothing wrong with dhikr. So they're making the adhkar of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remembering Allah as Allah jalla wa ala has commanded. That's what they felt. So then Abu Musa al-Ash'ari didn't say a word. What did he do? He went to a companion who was greater than him, who he himself saw to be greater than him, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. So he went to the house of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and he was the waqt of Fajr. It was the time of Fajr. And he waited outside the house of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. When Abdullah ibn Mas'ud came out, he said, I have seen something in the masjid. He said, what did you see?